That's right.
If you'd like to have a seat, that'd be great. Thank you for coming out and seeing me.
My name is Ed Sal, I'm the chairman of the Public Buildings Commission, and I welcome you to tonight's presentation on the library project. This evening, we're going to have a PowerPoint presentation, which will show you the current design of the project. And then at the end of the presentation, we'll have time for questions and answers, so if you could hold any questions until the end of the presentation, that'd be wonderful. I'd like to introduce Jesse Finney, who's the library director, who's going to start this evening's presentation. Jesse?
Thank you. Hi, everybody. As Ed said, I'm Jesse Finney, I'm the library director. Thank you so much for coming. The fact that you all came tonight means that you care about the project in the library, and we really appreciate that. We're really looking forward to hearing your feedback tonight. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about the designer selection process. So in 2010, the Board of Selectmen and town meeting attendees approved the library application to apply for a building improvement grant from the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners. Actually, I'm sorry, I'm going to turn the lights off for these slides. At that time, Johnson Roberts Associates was selected to prepare the initial design to illustrate where those building program components would go. And this was their initial design. During the lead up to the vote for town funding in December of last year, library staff, trustees, and foundation members met with hundreds, probably really thousands, of community members, as well as town groups, committees, and boards. And we received quite a bit of feedback, and a lot of it was concerns about the design. Some of those concerns included the exterior being out of keeping with our historic and residential neighborhood. Also issues with the large glass wing, such as heating and cooling, maintenance, and the materials cost of the glass itself to build that wing. Also the height of the addition. Right now we have a pretty high area in the center of the library. The height of the addition was actually greater than that. We all already have a little bit of an issue with noise control in the library, and we were hoping to have a project that would mitigate that, not add to it. So there were concerns that added height would add to that noise level. And then, one of the biggest concerns, I think, was that while there was this very nice new wing, the rest of the changes to the library were moderate. It really focused its energy on that addition. This whole building needs attention, and I think, this project we have today really addresses a lot of these issues. So, during the final design phase, the debt exclusion ballot for the funds in order to, and this is the language from the ballot, design, renovate, expand, and furnish the public library was successful. At that time, the project was turned over to the Public Building Commission. And they solicited for an architect that would be the best match for the town in terms of budget and design. And Odenzello Architecture was selected. So I think that there are numerous strengths to the Odenzello design, but I'm just going to talk about a few of them. For one, a very important thing, they incorporated all of our original components, program components that were approved by and required by the MBLC, the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners. The ideas for the exterior were more in line with the current building and with its setting here in a historic neighborhood. It completely transforms the interior space and highlights activity on both levels of the library. This is a renovation and expansion of the library, but it's really, this project is really a transformation of the existing building. It also brings in much-needed natural light to the heart of the library, and it consolidates staff and provides sidelines that allow for an easily manageable layout. And I want to just spend a few seconds talking about this, because this is a really important point to make, because when we went to the town with this project, we said that we could go forward with this project, which is, doubling, nearly tripling the size of the existing library, the usable space of the existing library, I should say, with the staff that we have currently. And the only way we can do that is by making sure that all of that building is manageable for us. So good sight lines, the ability to see in a number of spaces at once, these are all things that are really going to help with that. So the design process to date, The Public Building Commission oversees the process with day-to-day assistance from the owner's project manager, which is Daedalus, and library staff and trustees. Odenzello has held meetings with key stakeholders, town departments, and library staff to ensure that the library building program needs, as well as the needs of the town and community, are met. And really, that's why we're here today, because this public forum is an opportunity for you to give us your feedback and tell us what you're looking for in this project. We're pretty excited about what we have, and I'm really excited to introduce Conrad Ello, who's going to talk more about your design.
Thank you, Jason. Thanks a lot. I'm Conrad Ello from Odenzello Architecture. It's nice to be here tonight and to share the latest design work to date. It's important to point out that we're in the middle of a design process. This is not a final design that we're looking at tonight. We've done a lot of good work with a number of you over the last four and a half months. But it's a malleable thing. It's an iterative process, and so tonight's feedback from you is helpful and will feed into the larger process that we're involved with. Wanted to just reiterate what Jesse said. Our real thought about this project and one of our real charges is to look at this renovation and expansion as an opportunity to transform the existing building. This 1978 building has good bones, but it's got obviously much needed deferred maintenance that needs to be addressed, like the roof is past its service life, it needs new windows, all of those kind of infrastructural things that need to be improved upon. But also, when you think about this library, although it's an existing building that's 25,000 square feet, it's really, with the exception of this room on the lower floor, it's really a library on one floor, the floor above us. So it's really like we have a 12,000 square foot library. And we're moving towards what will be a 32,000 square foot library at the end of the day. So this is almost a tripling of space. And the quality of the spaces will be much better. There's things we're beginning to investigate and do with the new design that really does wholly transform the experience of this building. So these are just some images which bird's eye views that give a sense of where the additions go. The proposed additions will be our two-story additions. They total about 7,500 square feet. So the existing building, 25,000 square feet. The new two additions together are about 7,500, 7,200. And the big addition is off the front of the building heading towards Branch Street on the north, and there's another smaller, shallower addition on the east side. There's also a lamp in the middle, which helps bring some much needed daylight into the middle of a very deep floor plate that this building has. Another view of the same, showing that expansion to the north and east. I'm going to jump right into the floor plans, and we'll start on the upper floor. The main entrance to the building will remain where it is. There's some things I'll talk about a little bit later as it relates to the site work and improvements to the front area that I think will help with wayfinding and just providing for a more welcoming entrance. But the main entrance, vestibule, and lobby, and even the circulation desk more or less stay where they are currently, with some adjustments to improve sight lines. We've actually moved the circulation desk a little further in, so it's got a much better long view through the new building. The main device to organize that is a big open space. So you all are familiar with that larger high ceiling space upstairs. It's all very much dependent on electric lighting now. There's the tall stacks really block your view of the windows and the outside in this beautiful park-like setting. This new open space will be top lit by what we're calling a lantern. That's sort of a tall skylight element. But also we've worked very hard with Jessie and her staff to maintain very low stacks in the central area of the building. So from within this space, the sight lines, the wayfinding, the understanding of where you are on the building is going to be very, very clear. And so they're great sight lines all the way through the building, which is terrific for the staff as it relates to their control from that central circulation desk. These are the locations of the additions on the north and east side. I also will point out that in addition to this central space, which around which is really the adult area of the library, there is a wing where the current children's room is, and I believe it's new books, which also serves as a gallery. This will become mostly a staff wing of the building. There's some meeting rooms that I'll talk about a little bit later as well, but that's really the organization on the upper level. It's adults and the staff. There's a large central stair element and an opening in the existing floor that leads down to children's and teens, and again, we'll talk about that in a little bit. So I mentioned sight lines. This is a very important aspect of the design, especially as Jesse said, the staff size is not increasing, but yet here we are with a new library that's almost three times the size. So this is currently what one sees from behind the circ desk. This is largely also the view you get as you come in the front door, and those stacks really do block views, long views through the building and out to the landscape. And this is the intent of the new space inside. So the low stacks provide for very long views through the building. There's a new big bay window facing Branch Street to the north. Increased glazing in general on the north, east, and west sides. So there'll be a great sense of daylight. It'll be much brighter and much easier to navigate if you're a user of the library. I'll point out these trusses. It turns out that above the ceiling, there's a series of heavy timber trusses that exist. That's what holds up the whole existing roof. We've exposed those. They're actually in very good shape. The thought here is to bring a little bit of warmth and scale into this central space by exposing those. There'll also be some very interesting lighting. A cove light that will sort of backlight these trusses. It'll add a little bit of drama to this space at night. The lantern also will have lighting as well, so it'll maintain that beacon quality even at night. I'm just going to point out a couple of other of the kind of key program elements on the upper floor before we go down and look at the children's wing. The gallery, which is really an art gallery, doubles as a really nice, comfortable seating area. This dramatic central space has a lot of the computer stations and work tables and also stacks, part of the collection is there. But we want to make sure that the library has some great, comfortable areas to take a book aside and read and in more intimate settings. So this gallery, which is off of this central main space here, has great access to daylight. Comfortable seating along windows and being able to experience the artwork in a kind of intimate setting like that is quite nice. It's a challenge to work with a building that has such tight ceilings. The existing library has floor to ceiling is about 8 feet. But when you have such drama in the middle of a building, these low areas around the perimeter will actually feel quite intimate and feel nice and cozy in contrast to that central space. In addition to the gallery, we have two very nice, comfortable kind of reading nooks, seating nooks. One is the where the periodicals collection will be located here. That's basically on axis with your entrance. So as you look through the building, as you walk in the front door, we're marking that end of that view with a gas fireplace. This will be a nice, comfortable area to sit and read. Good south lighting. There's a nice corner window there. And the book club room, which can be scheduled for groups if they want to come in and use the room. It's sort of can be a private room, but it also, when the room is not booked, it has a sliding door that opens up, and so that can actually just double as it serve as another nice, comfortable seating area. Our firm just finished a new public library for the town of Millis, Massachusetts. It was opened about a year and a half ago, and this is their periodicals nook, very similar idea. And this was actually something they really requested. They wanted a fireplace in their library, and it's turned out to be the most popular space in the library. You can imagine on a winter day how nice it would be to have that kind of amenity in the library. In addition to those spaces, we have a local history room. There is a, I don't know if it's officially called the Situate Room or if it's the local history room. Someone referred to it as the Situate Room. It actually exists in this corner of the building now. It's locked, and it's locked because the collection itself is just sitting on shelves. It's not secured. The plan for this room is to develop built-in bookcases that have wired doors on them that are lockable. So the collection is there. It can be accessible with help from staff. But the room itself can be used, and there's great material in there that doesn't need to be behind lock and key. There's great maps, and this we see as kind of a nice, quiet workroom that we'd like to encourage the use of. And I think you probably get limited use of the existing history room because of the way the collection is handled in that space. What's nice about this room, in addition to being in a more central part of the library, it's adjacent to an outdoor reading porch, which then has a great view to the east of this, again, park-like setting. So that's also a nice amenity, this outdoor covered reading porch, which in the shoulder seasons and in the summer, it is fully covered. It's a deep porch, so it's shaded. But this is will be also another nice amenity, I think, for this library. And what's great about this is that it's up on the second level, so it's controllable. There's no way that folks can get up onto that porch from grade. So the library doesn't have to worry about this being a back door that somebody can sneak into. It's fully controllable, and even when it's maybe open for use, can be controlled by way of the doors. It's another library our firm did for the town of West Tisbury on Martha's Vineyard. It was opened about a year ago. A children's porch that's become a very popular amenity there. And same kind of idea that why not on nice days when you can take a book out and read outside, how great would that be? And especially in a setting like this, which has such a great yard around the library. I just want to also point out the meeting rooms adjacent to the staff suite. I mentioned that this wing of the building is really staff space. It's not entirely true. It's really about two-thirds of that wing that's devoted to staff offices. There is a scrim of two large meeting rooms that can be used by the town after hours. The library would be closed along this line of doors here. This has an independent entrance, so there would be a separate lobby and separate restrooms serving those two meeting rooms. So this is a great, in terms of flexibility and use by the town, it's nice to have that, that after-hours component. There's another after-hours component on the lower floor, so this building actually has quite a bit of flexibility as it relates to town functions. Before I move downstairs, I just want to point out, in the existing library, when you come in the front door, and you turn left and you look towards the north here, it's all full stacks with public restrooms that are very hard to find in the very back of the library, along with an elevator which comes down to serve this floor. The bathrooms are moving much closer to the lobby, they're much easier to find, and the elevator is moving fully across the length of the library, and it's going to be located adjacent to the circulation desk. So in terms of the new use of the lower level and access to the lower level, it's very easy. People come in, they're right in front of the circulation desk. There's a very clear path down an ample stair in the middle of the building, and then the elevator is right there as well. So heading down that stair, this is a view at the very bottom of that stair. You will benefit from the top lit, the lantern, which is directly located above the opening in the floor and the stair down. At the very bottom, this is also, sorry, a public stair we did in that West Tisbury library I mentioned. It's really very much a central part of the library, and it's a part of the life of the library, and we want to make sure that the two floors are very much interconnected, and the life of and activity on both floors is seen as one thing, not that we're relegating program down here as sort of back-of-house stuff are not as important. And this this central stair in your library and the big opening in the floor, I think, will help encourage folks to see this as a two-story library. So then at the bottom of the stair, right at the bottom of the stair, there's very clear entrances into two major wings. There's a children's area wing with its own program room. This suite is about 4,500 square feet, so significantly larger than the existing children's room, which is about probably half of this wing. So there's a substantial increase in the amount of real estate for children. And then, more importantly, because the teen area was sort of an afterthought upstairs right now, it's kind of just carved out of space in the main library just next to the circulation desk. The teens will have their own room, a dedicated room. And so these become kind of independent suites within the building. It's important that you don't come down the stair and find yourself in a long corridor with no windows and no sense of where you are. And so what we've introduced is some interior glazing. So views even between the teens and children's will be very clear. You'll be able to see the orientation. Again, visitor wayfinding will be very clear. And also it's important as you come down the stair to be able to clearly, immediately understand what's down there. Down a little hallway, and actually there's a slope to the hallway because this new wing we've built, this is the new addition. The grade is favorable to kind of go down a little bit in grade, and what we're trying to do is pick up ceiling height for a new program room. This new program room in the north end of the building accommodates about 150 people. It really will replace the function of this room, but it'll be significantly larger. And it's out near the front of the building so that in the evening or even no matter what activity goes on there, you see the life of the library from the street and it's an inviting thing. We didn't want to put this program room in the bowels of the building where at night when the lights are on, you have no sense of what's going on. So this is, we feel, has great possibility both for use by the library but also by the town. This is an after-hours suite as well and could be used for any number of receptions or functions with a door out to the yard. This could, receptions could spill out even onto the lawn. It has its own dedicated kitchen and separate bathrooms. And with this lower limited access entry, it really operates as an independent suite. Just quickly pointing out that the teens, there will be staff down at this lower level to monitor the children and the teens. There is an office that is shared by the teen librarian and the children's librarian and then their support staff. But the desks have been intentionally located kind of opposite one another and facing one another so that the sight lines that each station can help monitor the other. And if someone, one of those two librarians, has to run upstairs quickly for something, there are good sight lines from the other desk into the adjacent space. I mentioned the after hours meeting suite. So along this line, these doors can be locked after hours, and this can operate it as a meeting room for the town. I may be Ashley's going to help me talk a little bit more about what we're getting here in this new library relative to what you have now in the existing building. This is Ashley.
This is the existing upper level, which is the majority of the work as far as the functioning library. So you have the main adult stacks, the teen, and then the dedicated children's wing. You also have the circulation desk and some staff offices and the history room. And then as Conrad mentioned, the elevator and the two vertical circulation points of the stairs are marked in the deeper yellow. For our new upper level, we do want to dedicate the main floor to the main collection, the adult collection, and move this history room and also have that circulate as part of this reading area and staffs. The change here is that the back of house staff operation, where there's the processing and various activities that the staff has to do to support the library, will be centralized to the top floor. There's also clear glass partitions so that the staff has better views of the circulation desk and can help support the patron intake. There'll be dedicated staff at the circulation desk at the upper level and at the two lower level teen and children's wings. But having the primary back of house staff located up here with clear views out to the main entry points of the library and the main wing, we feel really helps to centralize the activity. We're also moving the two major points of vertical circulation closer into this entrance of the main library. The stairs Conrad spoke about, and then from what used to be the elevator over here, moving it just past the circulation desk. And then this part here is a after hours or during the day book drop where you can deposit books without going into the main library. As part of introducing and keeping a lot of the program that you have in the library, we've worked with several different members of the staff and parts of your community to understand the history, the gallery spaces, the book club, and the importance of meeting halls. And so we want to make sure that they're really reinvigorated and that they're part of the plan, but that they also aren't dead zones when they're not reserved. So all of these open up to become part of areas to read and to study during operating hours when they're not reserved. As you see, these deeper magenta are staff service points on the main library floor. So entering into the library with the circulation desk, and then moving out into the collection, the lighter blue are the stacks. We've calculated the stacks to hold the current collection as well as the projected collection over time. And with the increase of the square footage of the library, we're able to keep lower shelving to keep those views so that the staff has clear access to be able to interface with the patrons. And so that as you walk through the library, you have a better understanding of your park-like setting. This desk here is the reference desk, which will help utilize and opening up these collections that will be locked within the local history room. Also available to help answer questions on the floor. As part of the tables and computer layout, this bar here will be the dedicated computer spaces, and then these three long tables in the central area will be open tables ready for laptops and various types of research and studying. And then around the perimeter of the building, closer to the larger glazed windows, we have soft, comfortable seating. These in the gallery and these in this North Bay, looking out onto Branch Street. There are also three quiet study rooms that can accommodate small groups or single person studying. And then again, the book club that can be completely opened up when not reserved to accommodate the public. This is the lower level floor where we are here, and this green room in the center is the meeting room. So you see it's mostly surrounded by storage and staff use out here. And so, and again, this lower level entry, you have the circulation into these areas. So we're looking to bring down some of the services of the library into this space, having the dedicated children's wing and the teens moving the main program room out further north in the addition. Here you see the elevator with a path to these two wings, and out down this ramp here to the lower level entry. We are talking to the staff about various points of deliveries, trash removal, working with the various ramps and paths we have to the elevator. So that's something that we are continuing to develop with them. Also in the lower level, we're giving a stronger presence to the friends of the library. Currently they have utilize the storage facilities and then bring out books for sale periodically throughout the year. So there will be a dedicated storefront presence here in this lower level corridor with service support space for them to help process books that will be available for sale. And then we are keeping the back of house storage and mechanical in these zones here that are buried deeper into the ground. The these are the areas that are dedicated for community programs. So this community space can accommodate 155 people with in a seated lecture assembly. But it's flexible. It has its own storage room, its own kitchen, its own bathrooms for support, where there are numerous layouts you can do with tables or opening it up for larger events. This program room has two entries, one directly into the children's wing and one into this main corridor, so it can be a flexible program space between children and teen use. And again, here is that Friends bookstore and then their support area. I want to go over how we've zoned the children and the teens wing. So starting with the teens, here's the service point and the main access door. So people will be greeted by the teen librarian as they enter into this room. And she'll have clear views into this. Right here are a bank of computers and then two study tables and then soft seating by this window here with the books stacked along this quadrant. In the children's, again, you'll be greeted by a teen or child librarian at this desk. We believe there'll typically be two people at this desk, or it can at least accommodate that. Directly behind it is a children's librarian office. And so right now we have three stations in this office. This office has clear views out to this entry vestibule and clear views past this circulation desk. And so they can both monitor who's coming and going along this corridor, as well as help jump onto the circulation desk or out into this children's library to help patrons. In this zone here, we have a bank of computers for children, soft seating that can facilitate monitoring various programs that go in here. We have clear glazing partitions so that everything is very open. It's very easy to have kids in one room and also go into the stacks and be able to have views of where everyone is. And then we have study tables. This zone here is for toddlers. We have a corner here with window seating around for play area, the train table. There'll be soft seating so that you can read to your children. These all have views out onto the park. There is a door here that can be locked and monitored, but there can be access out into the area. And then this wing also has a dedicated AV section for children, and then a single bathroom just for convenience. And so with that.
Yeah, well, I'll try to move a little more quickly. We'll move into the exterior, but just before we do, I want to show some sections through the building. This is the existing building showing that central space that's quite high, and again, not really animated by daylighting and the transformation that one gets with that top-lit space, top-lit by way of the lantern. Cross-section through the building, again, showing the full-height stacks. Really a room here that has very little connection to the outdoors. And then that transformation again, outdoor porch, children's wing, teens wing here. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about the outside, and then we'll move to the site plans. The existing building is really brick and cedar. That's the palette. Our strategy of adding onto this building really extends or elongates that existing form. And so we're not trying to reinvent what the existing building looks like, but really add elements that complement it, bring a little bit more daylight into the inside, and speak to the community to the extent that we can. Certainly Lawson Tower has been a great guiding force for us, the beautiful shingle water tower. And I think the shingle roof here has a great tie-in to that. The shingle roof is way past its life, but we feel any other material would be the wrong decision here because it's such a huge roof that if you imagine that in metal or some other material, it would be so jarring. And there's a nice texture and warmth to that existing cedar. The good news is cedar technology's come a long way. And like the old cedar roofs that used to be, you couldn't do it in a conditioned building like this, where they're on the sort of strapping and allowed, the shingles are allowed to breathe from the inside and dry out from the inside, which extends their life. There are new products on the market like Cedar Breather, which allows any water that gets behind the shingle to run quickly down through the cedar breather layer and then out at the bottom of the roof, which promotes a quicker drying of the backside of the shingle. So we feel we can get more service life out of the shingle roof than what you've gotten to date with what I believe I've learned is now two rounds of shingle on this. It was installed initially in 78, and then there was a woman at the last presentation who said it's maybe 20 years ago a second round of shingle was installed. It's news to me, but that may or may not be true. Sorry, I didn't mean to jump ahead here. So the building extends towards Branch Street, and in the new areas of the building, we're actually introducing cedar siding, a shiplap siding. All of this, along with the roof, will weather to a silvery gray, but the same kinds of technologies that help promote drying for the roof shingles, we can implement in the walls as well. There are also treatments. You can pre-treat the siding before it goes on, which extends its service life, and we feel with the right selection of species, the right treatment to put on it, and the cedar breather on the backside, that we can look at the service life of the cedar siding in this case in the 30 to 40 year range based on the technology that's available today. There have been some questions about materials on the side, and that may come up in the questions. We can talk about that. Certainly brick, some people have asked why not brick. The main reason for that is cost, and the difference in cost between a brick wall assembly and cedar is quite substantial, and given the tight budget that we do have, we feel this is a great pairing. Certainly cedar and brick together are very handsome. You see that on a lot of buildings, and cedar is used, as we all know, all over the Cape, and it's a great weathering wood in an environment like this. Front view of the existing building. By the way, this brick is in great shape. It looks like we need to do very little to it, maybe not even repoint it as part of this new project. But the windows are dark, they're past their service life. We want to, all of the windows and doors in the building will be replaced. As I said, the roof shingles, all the roof fascias and soffits will also be replaced. And here's the new extended building showing the cedar extension and the lantern. This lantern, by the way, is represented in these renderings probably a little bigger than it will be in reality. We're trying to coordinate this with our structural engineers, and it probably will get a little bit smaller. In our schematic design budget, which we priced the project maybe a month ago, we priced that with copper flashing, which is great. Also, a lot of the details on Lawson Tower are done with copper, and that'll weather to the gray the green that we're all familiar with. So our hope is, again, the palette here of copper, little detailing, cedar and brick is a really handsome palette. The facade from Branch Street and that extension with great views into that program room from the street. And then on the east side, with the additions, the chimney element is a nice vertical marker, and it helps create a little bit of visual interest and punctuation in this very low, it's so dominated that the massing of this building by that big hipped roof, that the punctuations of the lantern and the chimney add some nice accents to it. So talking a little bit about the site, this project's more than just the building renovation and expansion. It's also a reinvigoration, improvement of the existing parking lot. And I think this has a huge impact on how visitors experience the building and come into the building. One of the things we've noticed since day one is that the cars that stack up along that sloped hillside as you come in off of Branch Street really block the view in combination with that very overgrown vegetation that's there now. There's some lovely plantings. A lot of these plantings we will actually remove and stockpile somewhere during construction and then reinstall them in new planting areas. So we're not just wholesale knocking all of that out of there, but it is overgrown, and the combination of the cars and the vegetation really don't invite people into the library. So by moving the cars, reorganizing where the stalls are, and reimagining the landscape in front of it, or even removing a couple of brick piers within the existing vestibule and using more glass there, it'll be far more visible and inviting from the street as you come up into the parking lot. So this is the existing parking lot. It's area-wise, it's quite large. And just the casual arrangement of parking stalls, it only yields 54 stalls. The new parking lot is going to be 106 stalls, so it's almost a doubling of the parking lot. However, it's not a doubling of paving. It's just reorganized in a far more efficient manner. So here's the site plan. Existing site plan with the existing drive lane in from Branch Street. You can see the large center island. This is a gifted landscape space. We're certainly mindful of that. Some questions came up in the earlier discussion about how we're honoring those gifts going forward. And I'll let Jesse and Karen talk about that a little bit later, but we certainly will reconfigure that gift in some other way, whether it's a garden space or somewhere else in the building. I just said it anyway. So here's the new site plan, the two additions, and the reconfigured parking lot. We are somewhat limited by some property lines along the south. I think we would have liked to, I think with respect, I know one of the abutters is here, the Beals, is that right? Yes, Mr. Beal. We'd love to pull that lot even further to the south, but we are limited by the property line. But the primary expansion is to the south and away from your property. So the limits of the, well, here we go. We can see the overlay limits. The limits of the existing parking lot relative to the new are very, very close. Just quickly point out the handicap parking locations. There are 9 handicap spots in the lot of the 106 total. The 5 here are up very high and very close to the main entrance. So these are the primary handicap stalls for the main entrance. There are 4 more handicap stalls located down at the lower end. The parking lot really slopes from high on this corner to low on this corner, but it's basically generally sloping high to low from this side to this side. So down at this lower level, those 4 stalls really serve that lower access point, especially when that community room is used after hours. So they're handicapped spots that serve that room, essentially. Wanted to point out, adjacent to the existing lot right now, there are large stands of invasive species, and this might be significant for you because it's closest to your property. But there's a big invasive species stand of Japanese knotweed. So as part of the reconfiguration of the parking area, the goal is to remove that stand. And that's a buffer, certainly in the summertime. And so that's something I'll be interested to hear your comments. We want to make sure we maintain that buffer. We're not taking any of the hardwoods down or any of the more significant plantings in that area. But there is a stand of invasives that we want to remove as part of this. Also as part of the parking lot design, this is really applicable to the whole property. We have an obligation by code to maintain all stormwater on site. The stormwater that's runoff that's coming off of the parking lot itself as it slopes down from high here to low really gets collected in a retention basin, which will really be like a rain garden. It'll be a garden element, not a bald part of lawn there. It'll have plantings in it. And that'll really handle the runoff from the parking lot itself. The roof has no gutters, and so that all drains into a drip strip a gravel bed along the base of the building, and then that ties into a subterranean stormwater retention system. But the goal here is not to shed stormwater off onto abutting properties. It's all going to be contained on the property itself. That's the end of the presentation. I just want to point out that this is a real process. It's not just a design team that's designing a building. It's a collaboration with a number of entities and institutions. This is a list of folks that we have been interfacing with over the last 4 or 5 months. And obviously tonight is the general public's opportunity to weigh in. So with that, we'll open it to questions, and thank you for listening. And the questions aren't all, hopefully not all for me. I hope these guys can help answer a little bit.
Do you have any questions?
Is there opportunity for additional changes to be made? Obviously not dramatic, but and stay within the budget that the town has proposed for this project. So is it?
The budget, admittedly, is very tight. We're going to price it 2 more times before it goes out to bid. The next time, the next price will come in mid-January. So we'll have to see with this design where we are in mid-January. But I'll say it's a very, very tight budget. And there are things that, the more you learn about the project as you go further in the design process, there are sometimes curveballs that come out that hit you. And there's one we may have to contend with, which is the flow rate of the water, the town water in under Branch Street might not be able to support the pressure we need and the volumes of water that we need for an automatic sprinkler system here in the building. So this building currently is not sprinkled. By code, it's required to be sprinkled. The new building will be sprinkled. And so there are investments in systems like that. You can put underground tanks and pumps in lieu of the water from the town line. But those kinds of things are always hitting you left and right, and so it's very hard to dream of amenities that you would love to have going forward, just because you're running on a tight budget, and there are things like that that are always feeding it. But if somebody, I guess, if the foundation raises enough money, and maybe unless you want to talk about it, then we can talk about some things. But yeah, minor things for sure, and we want to make sure we address concerns. If there are serious concerns about some of the things we're doing, there's room for change.
On materials, like I know you're saying about the cedar roof and all that stuff like that. If you put 2 roofs on in 36 years?
Well, that was news to us. We thought this was the original roof from 78, and that looks like it's gotten 40 years of use. Someone was saying a roof had been installed 20 years ago. You should be able to get a cedar roof that lasts longer than 20 years. That doesn't look like 20 years of wear to me.
And what about like a synthetic slate or something like that?
It was news to you too? Yeah, I don't know if that was true. Maybe I misspoke. We need to do some research. I'm hoping it's the original roof, in which case that would make more sense. Synthetic slate would be an option. It's probably more expensive than the shingles, the cedar shingles.
Certainly, I know the cedar looks great on the outside, but they did the Alston Library in Boston, and they used cedar on the outside. And that was probably, 20 years ago? And it really looks pretty crappy now.
Yeah.
The bleeding and the nails and stuff like that.
Yeah, that I know the story behind that. And actually, the contractor didn't use stainless fasteners, and
they replaced it afterwards.
Yeah,
they were made to replace it. Still,
yeah.
Today it looks pretty rotten.
Yeah,
I mean, I didn't know it looks great at the beginning. One other thing on the inside of the building: what's the plans for materials, wood materials, and everything?
We're using wood in limited ways. Again, the budget is lean, so. But for some special elements, maybe some of the elements within the history room, we'll try to use some wood veneer in the cozy reading nook where the periodicals are. Generally, the palette is going to be durable materials. We haven't really settled on all the materials on the inside. There'll be a lot of carpet, certainly in the adult children's floors. Acoustics are very important, so acoustic treatment in the ceiling is where you get the biggest bang for your buck. There'll be acoustic materials, whether it's a lay-in ceiling in some cases or a troweled-on acoustic material, for example, in the large space. But limited use of wood. Carpet will allow us to bring some color in. There's a lot of color in the palette just by virtue of the books. The furniture, all of that is sort of a little further down the road. We haven't made those decisions yet.
I've worked on a lot of libraries, and one problem material we used was bamboo. And those have made major callbacks and movement of the wood and stuff like that.
Bamboo can be a good source. I don't know the story behind your problems with it, but
the flooring was good, but anything we put on walls and stuff. Major movement and splits and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Thanks for your
comment.
I wanted to follow up on that. Do you have an idea of what the cedar siding would cost versus the brick? Because it just has twice the light rate.
Yeah, the brick, I mean, no doubt about it, the brick, you get a lot more life out of the brick. This is 40 years old and it's probably got another 50, 60 before it's even worth talking about. I mean, it's just in great shape. And we like it, and the good news here is that as part of this renovation expansion, we're keeping all of that brick, and it's being re-infused and reused into this new design. But you've asked a question that we know we need to answer. In fact, we were just talking about it just before the meeting, that we've got to run the numbers on that to really see if it's within range, and if it's within range, then that's something we can think about. We do like the use of the cedar. If you think about it, the overall enclosure being brick, it is quite fortress-like now, and adding some wood elements. I think even if we were to bring some brick into it, it may not be for all of it. But you could imagine that extension off the north, which is really an elongation of the building, being brick to match the existing. And then maybe that east addition still being cedar. So it's a good question. We do need to run the numbers. We don't have those.
And the other question I had, you have no gutters on the newer than existing, and especially with cedar siding, is there a provision made for splashing off the ground to keep it from discoloring and rotting?
Yeah, the good news also is that we have, in many cases, 5-foot overhang, so you're pretty far out. We do have a drip strip that controls the splashing. It's not coming down onto hard surfaces, and so that helps as well. Someone brought up yesterday in a meeting that, you know, in the valleys, the water, when you have a really heavy rain, it's like a hose shooting water up there. So there are a couple of conditions like that we have to work on. I think you were next, sorry.
How was the $12 million budget that arrived at? What was the basis for that?
That was the initial cost.
Now, this was determined back in 2012. Was that based on the $5 million award that you came up with $12 million?
Was it based on what, sir? I'm sorry, I didn't hear that last part. I'm sorry, I didn't hear that last part of what you said.
Was it the $5 million award based on the $12 million proposal?
It is. It's I'm sure some of you are familiar with the MSBA, the school project that's in town right now. We have a similar reimbursement schedule with the MBLC, the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners. They will reimburse 50% of what they consider eligible costs. The things in our project which are ineligible are the parking lot, the temporary quarters that we're going to need, the library, the moving costs. So those things detract a little bit, which is why it's not an even, you know, split between the town and the MBLC. But that $12 million initial budget was based on the grant round.
And that's expected to rise.
That's expected to what?
That's going to rise.
No, sir, we're not going back to the town for any more money. Okay. So, no, we're living within the budget that we have.
Is the town receiving any reimbursement at the present time for design part work?
Yes. We've already received $1 million to date. And we'll be receiving another million in the spring.
Are there any conditions attached to the grant?
Absolutely. There are a number of conditions attached to the grant. Yes. Yes, I'll elaborate.
Would you recite them?
Yes. So, for instance, all of the different programs, if you took a look at the layout of the design, the children's room, the teens room, having dedicated staff space, having a community room, all of these things that we, when we applied for the grant and told the Board of Library Commissioners, these are the things that we're going to have, they expect to see that. So, for instance, if we brought to them a design that no longer had a teen room, they would say, well, you know, you need to go back and work that in because that's what we're funding. There are also other stipulations that the town is beholden to. For instance, when you take the NBLC's money, you're agreeing to keep this building as a dedicated library for 20 years. So that's one of the stipulations of the funding. You know, those are the biggest ones. We have to continue to be, you know, a free, open library.
And when do you expect to come up with a final budget?
This is the final. So the $12 million is the final budget. So what we're doing now is if something comes up in the project that rises, you know, the cost of the project, we'll have to take a look and see what we can do to mitigate that.
I wish the budget were changing with you. It's not. So we've got to work to that budget.
Which means you can't go up to bid unless you have the total money available.
Well, the money has been funded through the override vote already, so the funding is totally in place, and which is one of the reasons why we have to make that budget, because I'm pretty sure that's all the money we could go and ask for. So
if the cost of the project goes up to $17 million or so, then you have to cut back on the project.
Yeah, if it went out to...
Or find sources of money to balance the budget.
If it goes out to bid in May and comes back as a $14 million job, it's a non-starter. We've got to go back and look at ways to get it on budget. That's the charge of, the collective charge of the Public Buildings Commission, the design team, the library staff, the trustees, and we're all working together towards that. And that's partly why you have these estimates in place before you go out to bid.
One more question on that. Was there any conditions imposed on the article to authorize $7 million?
Just the conditions that I've already listed about keeping it as a library for 20 years and, you know, having all of those programs.
So the commitment right now by the town is $7 million.
Correct. It's $7 million offset by any private fundraising by the Scituate Library Foundation. So far they've raised $750,000. They hope to raise $2 million towards the project.
So the shortfall is what, $2 million?
The shortfall.
No shortfall.
Well, I don't think there's a shortfall.
Well, the $7 million is unappropriated.
Correct.
And
$5 million from the NBLC is $12 million.
And what is the money raised by the Friends for the Library and the pledges, and what's the private match coming in?
They hope to raise $2 million. Okay, so far, they've raised $750,000.
All of those funds will go to reduce the $7 million amount.
That will bring it up to $9 million.
Debt will go down.
It's going to reduce the tax burden.
I was trying to raise the resources here.
I wish.
Okay.
Sorry, you were. I think you were next. Excuse me. I'll get you. Yes.
Hey. Oh, yes. I think it's a great plan that's presented tonight. What's the end of the open public response waiting period? Like, when does that happen? It looks like at the end of January, we'll be having sessions, because you're talking about taking feedback. It's kind of a malleable project, taking input from the public. When does that end? And is there an email address, or Jesse, should people come to you? Stop by and see you. But if someone says, could you incorporate this or any further questions beyond these open forum meetings to you?
Please, my email address is on the website. You can come in and see me, you can call me. I'm happy to talk about this. I think, we may have further public forums down the line, but this is really the chance for people to sort of see it.
So it's the best opportunity to influence it in any way, because the further you go down the line, the tighter, the harder it is to make those changes. But after tonight, if a question hasn't been asked and you think of something in the next 2-3 weeks, it's going to be fine, and we'll certainly take those into consideration.
Yeah, just one more question. Now, looking at the downstairs, did the group feel there was enough delineation between the toddler, the child, the teens areas? Was there any comments or concerns about this? Because there's none of that upstairs. Right. Now we're used to seeing teen children upstairs. I mean, I understand teens will be upstairs.
Yes. No, teens will be downstairs.
And right now, they're kind of...
Oh, I'm sorry, there. Yes.
But in this plan, the plan is put the teens down with the children, with the toddlers, and I don't know what... that's what I'm trying to get at.
Different rooms. So the reason, I think maybe some of the confusion might be, we talked a lot about the sight lines between the two, so there is going to be that interior glazing so that the two librarians can see each other and can kind of help monitor each other's areas. But there will be separate spaces with doors, and you know they won't be necessarily hanging out together.
Yeah, so there's within the children's room, there's a fine-grained delineation between toddlers, early readers, and school-age kids, but the teens are in there in an entirely separate space. They've got their own world, environment to enjoy. You were next.
Question on the lantern. I know you talked about the architectural features of kind of breaking up the roof line and stuff, but I've seen lanterns on commercial and residential buildings where they more or less mimic the roof, they're raised, but they more or less mimic the roof line.
Right.
Rather than having a rectangular, are they more like this? Would that limit the amount of light that you're trying to receive into the rooms?
That's part of it. And to be honest, we are very close to a height limitation by zoning. So. It's a combination of trying to bring in as much light as we can, stay under the height limitations.
Yeah, I wouldn't that's driving it higher, but just instead of doing angular feature,
if you were to pitch
more angle.
Yeah, if you pitch that roof, what happens is you do reduce some of the area of glazing. It is something that's come up. I know someone, at least one of the person, has asked about pitching that. It does have a pitch, just so you know. It does shed water, it's not dead flat, but I understand what you mean, something that really is a little more significant and it's following the slope of the main.
Exactly.
Yeah. Mr. Beal. Did I get it right? Is it Beal?
Yeah, you did. Thank you. First off, thank you very much for acknowledging us. My wife Janine and I, we are abutters. We're also big fans of the project, and I've sat here in other meetings and said, it's taken me less time to walk here than most of you to drive here. The parking lot is going to impact us. I have some questions about, you brought up, I like the overlay of current versus the proposed. First off, stormwater management. Right now, there's a lot of stormwater that comes out. Just the rain we've had these last few days, I think, is a good example of what can happen. The Japanese knotweed, for us, it's kind of a double-edged sword. I know it's an invasive species, but it also provides a nice screen because the character of the parking lot changes on the weekends after about 11:30. There's some things that go on over there that no one in this room would want in their backyard. Just let you fill in the blanks. But could you talk a little bit more about the stormwater, the invasive species, and then from the where the pavement is now, how much further, I guess, north do you see it, the pavement migrating in the new layout?
A lot of questions in there, and I'll try to.
I didn't mean that.
No. And we may at some point, because you are in a butter, and at some point we may want to have a more detailed conversation. We're sensitive to your situation. The knotweed really does need to come out. That I think we all feel committed to that. There are opportunities to replace that in kind with some screening, maybe not as fully robust as that stand of knotweed is now, but we could talk about some screening landscape there, at least in part. the line of where the existing paving or the new paving will be relative to the existing, it looks like it on the plan now that I saw tonight and you did, it looks like it might be coming a little bit closer to you, not a lot, but a little bit marginally. But we're trying our best to shove that thing as far south as we can, knowing that situation. We're not getting into the meat of that buffer zone. We definitely don't want to change that. But there's still room to look at it. We have a meeting with our landscape designer Monday. So it's something we will talk to them about too, and if there's any way we can tighten certain things up to pull that even further south away from you, we'll do it. Stormwater management, I don't know, you're saying some of the water sheets off the parking lot now and gets down. I mean, I can imagine the last couple of days you noticed something.
You noted how the parking lot tips away from the library, and then it sort of tips in sort of two directions. A lot of stormwater comes off the far corner of the parking lot, and we catch that as well. So we talked to the town about just putting in just a berm, just a simple, you know, dump truck load of gravel to do it. And we haven't been real successful in getting the storm drain cleaned out. We do that.
Right.
We're sort of the guardians of the storm drain, self-serving reasons, but we're over there in the fall shoveling leaves off, because otherwise it ponds up and we do get sheet flow that comes across.
I know the grading of the parking lot has changed a little bit, and it's trying to divert all of the water to that retention basin that I pointed out. That's new. It's a whole kind of bowl there that will collect, hopefully, all the sheeting water coming off the parking lot. But we can look at along that north line, of the whole length of the parking where that knotweed is now. We can look at ways of trying to create a trough that directs it to that retention basin. So there's something there that combats overflow that goes off of the library property onto your property. So there's opportunity, I think, in your case where we should talk maybe more in a different setting where we've got more detail. And we haven't quite worked all the details out.
Sure, thank you.
I have two questions. I've worked with some groups that we've used the kitchen facilities. Are they about the same size in the new with the new plan as they are here?
This is sort of a staff kitchenette, or is it? It's
no,
also
this
used
one over
for this
here.
Space
well,
too.
I know that we've been able to utilize it, you know, when we've had functions down here, but it's no smaller than that.
It's probably more.
Well, that's a break room.
That's more
too,
of a break room. So that program is really going to go upstairs related to the staff wing. So the kitchen that's down relative to the new program room is dedicated to that program room. So you're not getting the lounge component of it. It's really a kitchen, but I think it does have more counter space than probably what you have.
And then my second question, did anybody this afternoon talk about the Memorial Beach tree over here to the north side?
Yes, we did talk about that today.
Great, thank you.
You talked to me after.
No, as long as they...
So two questions. One, what is the impact of the renovation and the addition on the number of volumes that you have? I know Hingham did a pretty large, I think almost doubled their space at the library and did a renovation. And I heard that it's, I think it was the same number or slightly fewer books that were possible there because of handicap accessibility and lower shelving, and et cetera, et cetera. So what is the impact on the number of volumes?
That same thing might have happened here if it weren't for the fact that we're going from what's really a 12,000 square foot library on one floor to a 32,000 square foot library here. So we've got a lot more space, but the collection's only, or the volume, the capacity in the new library is only increasing a little bit.
I asked them to plan for 15% growth in most areas, 20% in some of the areas where we're a little light. You know, there are a lot of different opinions about how the collections are going to go from, you know, now to the next 5, 10, 15 years. Most of us in this field envision the collections either staying about the same or even shrinking, but we are planning, you know,
there's more
growth.
Yeah.
And so I think that, you know, I think we're in a really good position. And we're also planning, we're planning for growth, but we're also planning that, you know, if that does happen and our collection shrinks a bit over the years, that we can move things around and keep things very flexible so that, you know, we can take stacks out. And these are all, for the most part, really low stacks. So moving things around, you know, right now, if you want to take a stack out, you know, it's extremely expensive. You have to bring special teams in. It's no easy task, but these will be, you know, easily movable pieces of furniture.
I think there's around, just in terms of quantities, there's around 75,000 volumes now.
Around 80, actually.
80, and it's going to 90, low 90s or something like that. So we are increasing the capacity.
And if you folks talk with that, I know in getting, it looks like the parking lots are right all the way down to the property line, right? So I don't, who's, are you guys talking to that, the butter, wherever that butter is? I don't know. On the south side?
Yeah.
It's town.
But it's not the library's property.
Yeah, it's okay.
Right,
that's right. So it's town.
Sorry, go back.
I'm just wondering if any ideas have been put forward to bring the community into the design. Space on Broad. I've lived all over the country, and Scituate is such a strong community, and like the people here are so great. And I've seen, you know, designs where perhaps like, you know, it could be maybe a fundraiser. You know, people could donate a tile or something that could be used in like a walkway outside or, you know, on a wall somewhere, just to bring the community into the building and have people able to come back and see like, oh, this was what I liked back here, you know, or something like that.
Yeah, we've talked a lot about stuff like that for fundraisers. The foundation actually would be the group that's kind of considering different things. I know in one of the libraries that Odenzello has worked on, they did these really amazing tiles, painted tiles, that, and they're in the children's room, and all of the people actually donated, and then, you know, they were able to display the work. Some people do bricks, which is also a very lovely thing. You know, so they're considering a lot of things, but, you know, we're still, I think, not quite to where we want to be in design to know where all of those areas of opportunity are being,
for that sort of question.
Yeah, we're all supportive of that. I don't know, Les, do you want to talk to that a little bit?
You know, we have a general fundraising that's going on. Actually, four levels of fundraising. We're soliciting local businesses. We're soliciting foundations. We have a large donors program, and we have something we call 1,000 Homes, which we're trying to get 1,000 people to give us $1,000 each over 4 years. In addition, we're looking at multiple other programs. We're investigating a number of things, as Jesse said. One is a program we saw that we're thrilled about, with a whole bunch of fishes with people's names on them. Mm-hmm. And another one is the idea of tiles at, or bricks. And another one we've seen is something we call a word garden. And word gardens, where you get a whole bunch of words on rocks, and people, kids just go in and move the words around and make sentences and so forth. And so you pay $100 to buy a word or whatever. So there's multiple things like that. And you want to run a program with us, we'll be more than happy. I'll give you an application form for to name the library after yourself.
Thank you. I have a question.
Could you speak a little bit about the heating and air conditioning systems and whether or not those are going to be upgraded as part of this project, and you know, if they're in scope as part of that?
Yeah, they are. The whole heating and cooling system is going to be completely redone as part of this project. But the good piece of that, the good news, is the heating and cooling system for this existing building was replaced in 2009. Pretty significant replacement of all of the units, and those units still have a lot of life left, and our engineers have determined that they're viable for the new design, the new layout. So we actually are reusing them, relocating them into different rooms, but the units themselves can be saved. That helps with the budget. It's a sustainable thing to do instead of throwing them out. So, and actually the condensing units as well, even though they're in a remarkably hideous chain link pen out in the back. Those condensing units can also be reused. We're just relocating and putting them behind cedar fencing and kind of organizing them in a better way. So, but all of their, and I should mention there are underground ducts. This is slab on grade, concrete slab on grade. We are tying into that. We're trying to use as much of the existing system as we can. There's some big duct work up in the attic on the second floor that we're going to tie into. So not all of that will come out, but because it's a new space and program elements are in different locations, there's obviously a lot of new piping and new ductwork extensions that build on that. But the core elements we're holding on to from the existing building.
First, I want to say this is a much better look than the conceptual one, much more sustainable. So that way. I have one question. The stair going down, you actually had a picture of a woman with a child and nobody could pass. How wide is this going to be? Because, see, I mean, if it's, because it looks kind of narrow, and of course, it's, I don't know the concept of that. Because that's going to be a major circulation.
Yeah. It's a good question. And you're hitting on something with West Tisbury. It's a smaller building, for one. It is borderline, two people can pass. I think two people can pass on that stair. Maybe the photo is wrong. But this stair is wider than that one. I don't know, Ashley, if you know the width, or Chelsea.
6 or 7 feet.
Yeah, so it's pretty gracious stair. Right, it's not, certainly two people.
So it's going to have a center rung in it or something.
It won't have a center rail, but it'll be wide enough for two people to pass comfortably. Yeah.
That one showed 36 or 48 inches.
It's narrower than the one we're planning here, for sure.
Now, the stormwater management and stuff, I believe when the senior center was designed to be off the back end of the parking lot, that area was in the, there are some wetlands out back there. Have you guys gone and investigated to make sure what the delineations were back there?
For wetlands?
Yeah. Knotweed usually grows in wetlands, so.
Yeah.
Have you discussed
that? Yeah, we've looked at the maps, the town maps. It's all part of the zoning documents, and we're not in a wetland. There's nothing.
No, I don't think you are. Yeah. Right, but parking lot.
No, even park. I think the entire property, there's no wetlands.
No, I'm saying the adjacent property has it, and they've already been delineated. Because I know that when they did the senior center and they started design out there, I was on the commission then, and there were wetlands delineated back off the end of the parking lot.
Yeah, we still have in front of us, going in front of all of the town agencies, and there's even some informal conversations with the fire marshal and the building inspector, all that coming up very soon. If we encounter a wetland situation where we've got to go in front of Conservation Commission, that's just part of the process, and we will, and we'll be obligated to. We won't have a choice. So we'll get there, but we're not at that moment where we're having those conversations. And I don't believe we have any issues to contend with on this property. That's my early understanding.
And are they replacing the water main on Country Way in here? Because I know they just did it on Hathaway, the water pressure, my house went up significantly.
We want to tap into that line, maybe that line.
So it's not close enough, but I don't know. I might need to know if all the water mains, because the water mains are being upgraded so much, that means they can patch your fire pump.
Yeah. We don't know. The jury's still out on that. I did mention the lower pressure and that. Yeah. So we're doing a new test on Monday, and fingers crossed we've got the right pressure in the line here. So we don't know for sure if we've got
it wrong. If the water main is going to be replaced, then those numbers have changed a bit in a year now.
I don't know the answer to that. I don't know if there's any thought of upgrading it here.
I think we're going to try. You know, this is going to be replaced anyway, so I think they're actually going to try to time it with the construction of the property, but I don't know if that's the same line. This is the tap water, you know, that we're talking
about. Yeah, that's the same line.
It's a main that serves both domestic and fire water.
Oh, yeah. Okay. It's a street main. I mean, the street main being replaced, then the test that you do now will be much lower than you will probably have in Annapolis, too. keep that in mind.
That's good to know. I wasn't aware that they were upgrading.
I don't know if that would be, but we have 22 miles of water main stations in place now. So.
We'll probably have to wrap up in a few minutes, so maybe we could take a few more questions.
You can address them and I'll grab you.
I'm just curious, how do you decide what books it's from the existing collection that you're going to get rid of? And you said you had 90 volumes and now you have 80 volumes? Was that
90,000?
I'm sorry, 90,000. Does that mean you got rid of 10,000 volumes? Because a lot of my favorite books have disappeared. And I've talked to other people there, the audiobooks have disappeared. And I know that's the way libraries are going.
It's not necessarily, I won't say it's the way libraries are going. We did a massive weeding project this year, and weeding for us declassification is basically when the library, we do quite extensive research before we do this. We don't just go to the shelf and say, I don't like that book anymore. So we do research on how often it's circulated in the period of time, and we have to weigh that against the rest of the collection and say, well, you know, this volume, you know, has gone out 5 times over the last 15 years. This volume has gone out 30 times over the past 5 years.
But I wonder if patrons should have a vote on some of these decisions.
Well, I mean, that's what you pay us for. We have a collection development policy, and that is our touchstone. That's our guideline. It's actually on our website, and you're more than welcome to see the reasons that we decided to take it out of the collection. One of the biggest things we did this year, though, is condition weeding. So your favorite book might be a wonderful book that we love, but it might be in terrible condition.
No, it was in good condition.
Okay. It was, well, I don't know which book it is exactly, but
the biggest thing that's disappeared is when I moved here decades ago, you had a collection of Samuel Woodruff poetry. He wrote The Old Open Bucket, and that book is gone. It's only available. I asked the women at the desk. They said, you can get it on demand online. Well, that's $40. And it just seems that this town...
Are you referring to our online book collection, which is free?
No. I don't know. There was some confusion about that. So it just seems that he lived in the town. The Old Oaken Bucket is what made the town famous. And that, you know, that book should have been kept. Maybe it's in your historical collection.
I was going to say, I think it's probably going to be in.
But it's not online. It's not on the OCLM catalog, so nobody's going to be able to find it. You know, it should be known that it's here. It used to be here.
Motion to buy the book.
Second.
Well, I mean, and that's one thing that we're doing. So we're keeping lists of the books that we are taking out of the collection, mostly for condition.
Yeah.
And we'll start purchasing those again. But every item that we have in this library is going to have to be stored during the time that this project is being done, with the exception of a very, very tiny amount of items that we'll be able to take with us. That all costs money. So, you know, we're trying to have a strong collection that circulates. And, you know, to make room for the newer items, you do, unfortunately, in a library, have to take, it's always a difficult issue, but you do have to remove items. It's just the way that we have to do things here.
And so you said you have explanations online?
We have a collection development policy, and that explains what we purchase, why we purchase, and when we decide to take something out of the collection. That was approved by our Library Board of Trustees. You can always come to a trustees meeting if you feel like something in the policy should be revised or changed.
And that's online at the regular website?
Yes, ma'am. On our town, yes. Under the library policy.
Sorry. We could say various types of floorings, different rooms, different floors, or anything to mix it between, you know, tile or wood or carpet.
Yeah, there is going to be a mix of floors. I mentioned carpet in large areas of the stacks for the adults, children's, and teens. in high traffic areas, like in the front door, it would not be carpet. You know, it would look terrible in a short order of time. So it's got to be a more durable material. We talked about some tile. We have talked about wood flooring at one point. And a lot of these decisions haven't been made, but there will be a variety of floors that kind of respond to the areas that they're in. For example, the children's program room, you know, they might have crafts and painting projects. You're going to have probably a sort of a sheet linoleum type of product down in a room like that, whereas in comfortable seating areas, we'll have something softer like carpet. So there's a variety of finishes and materials that go into it, and we're not quite there on all of them yet. I'll keep answering questions, but you guys are kind of shut it off. You had your hand up first, and then we can maybe take it.
I just wanted to comment on the design. I think the design is much more appropriate to the environment, as the colleague over here said. I'm looking forward to how it develops further.
Yeah, thank you.
We're really keen, so.
Thank you. We're very excited. I think everybody so far has been encouraging.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, sir.
I know you're going to expand and improve the restrooms throughout the building, correct?
Correct.
We also evaluate, you know, we have a wastewater pump station up here. Would you upgrade that?
You're talking about right outside the building here?
The pump station pumps the wastewater from this building into the sanitary sewer system. You ought to look at it out back.
Okay, I just want to make sure I understood what you were talking about. We're aware of that, and it's actually in the zone of the new addition, so it has to be replaced anyway.
You are.
We are addressing that. The wastewater lines under this slab on grade, we have to. It is what it is, because we're not going to be tearing up
the
floor.
And that's the pump station that pumps it.
The pump station, so the wastewater comes out of this building at a low elevation. It's got to get up to the main sewer line. Okay, yeah, so it will be upgraded. Yeah. Yes, sir.
What technology will exist in the meeting rooms?
Good question.
We're going to have, since we have a number of meeting rooms, we'll have different technologies kind of depending on the location. We're thinking in the very large program room, we'll have a drop-down projector with a screen. We'll have motorized shades, which will make it very nice. You can open them when you're doing a presentation, when you're not doing a presentation, but when you are, you can close them and have that without us necessarily shutting off all the lights. And there's a couple of smaller meeting rooms. One of the things that a lot of people are using now are sort of smart screens, LCD screens, where you are just literally plugging in your computer and presenting from that. So in one of the smaller meeting rooms, we can envision doing something like that. We would love to have, you know, the ability to show, you know, movies, you know, or play video games in the children's program room, which is also going to double as a teen program space. And we envision that as more of, a cart that we bring out. So, it kind of depends on the place. Do we want to take one last question? Anybody have one last question? Or? No, not them all. Okay, well, thank you guys so much.